You're listening to Modern Male Radio with Jerod Zavistoski and Sydney Hall, right here on LA Talk Radio.
What's up, everybody? I'm your host, Jerod Zavistoski, and you're listening to Modern Male Radio. This is all the stuff your mama should have told you and the shit your daddy never knew. And joining us tonight, we've got some special guests. But first, my co-host.
That's right. I'm your host, Sydney Hall. What's up, Modern Male Radio?
And we've got in the house tonight, we've got the very sexy Brooke Haven back for what, a fourth time, fifth time?
Oh, I've lost count. Yeah. I don't know. I feel like we're just in this radio relationship now. I know.
Don't tell your boyfriend.
Uh-oh.
And my girlfriend's watching the show right now.
And he was here, so I think we're good.
Yeah, right? We got so many hits that day, by the way. And I was trying to figure out if it was your hotness or his hotness that like made
Maybe
every...
all of our hotness together that day.
Yeah, right?
It was the a pretty
collective
hot hotness.
It was a collective hotness. Yeah. And with us tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a very, very special guest, Jesse Sink. You are a pro athlete, bodybuilder, and motivational speaker, yes?
Yeah, absolutely. Men's physique. I'm not doing bodybuilding at the time, but men's physique, yeah.
So what is that? What's the difference?
Men's physique is, you know what, let's cut it short. You don't wear the spandex.
Oh!
So little, no spandex. Yeah,
so it's a heterosexual version of bodybuilding.
Yeah, you could put it that way.
Okay, awesome. And with us tonight as well, ladies and gentlemen, calling all the way in from Chicago, we've got Ian, was it Kalfen of the...
Kalfen,
man.
Kalfen. Of the Good Looking People, or the GLP Movement. Say hi, Ian.
Correct.
What's up, Ian?
Nothing much. How you doing over there in Los Angeles?
Hey, you know, we're trying to keep it a little cool over here. You know what I'm saying?
I'm wearing it. Cool. It's hot as hell over here.
Yeah, well, I'm wearing a jacket, but it's for
cold
show.
Now. It's
kind of
cold.
Tonight it might be chilly.
It's cold.
But I was at the Playboy Mansion in a bikini yesterday.
All of us are bundled up, but,
you know,
but Jesse.
No. If we're wearing a jacket right now, it's for show. This is like paper thin, and I'm still sweating. It's hot. It's hot as crap right now. You wouldn't think, for being Thanksgiving, that it would be this hot.
People are shoveling driveways. I was in a bikini all day yesterday. It's not cold in LA. Don't be fooled. Don't believe the hype.
Winter's getting to be the best season in LA. So cool.
Get below 70.
How's the weather out there in Chicago, Ian?
Oh, my God. It's as bad as you would imagine out here. I mean, I just got back from inside and just snow in my face. But,
see?
Yeah.
And that's why we're in LA.
That's Chicago for you.
Well, I'm sorry.
That's right.
I'm sorry for that. We're just going to keep rubbing in LA's good weather. We're just going to keep rubbing
in. I was drinking those pina coladas in the grotto yesterday and laying out at the pool.
That's right. You just got back from the Playboy Mansion.
I did.
All right.
I'm suntanning right now.
Rubbing in.
Still got my sun. I brought the sun with me.
Yeah, I was outside in a tank top
and shorts. Anyone that's watching knows that I'm not suntanning. Or it's a very good suntan.
Yeah, I want to know.
Yeah. What is your secret?
It's a very good suntan.
Yeah, what is your secret?
Give me some of that.
Genetics.
Some of that good bronzer.
Cool. So, Ian, because we got you on radio, why don't you tell people a little bit about yourself?
Well, I just started up, I'm 24. I just started up this company, GLP, a couple years ago. As I mentioned, you know, earlier to you, Jerod, and, you know, your show kind of fits in great about confidence. That's something that I know you love to talk about and a lot of things that you overcame in your life to get where you're at now. It's about, the tagline is confidence from within. There's people of, you know, Down syndrome, people who overcame so many things. We work with, you know, we work with the military and lots of people like that who kind of overcame stuff to get where they are now through actually inner confidence. It's not necessarily focusing on the celebrity like Jordan or Kobe, but people that don't necessarily get recognized on a daily basis through mainstream media.
That's cool.
Yeah, the people that were at a disadvantage
everyday
still
people.
Became successful.
Everyday people, right?
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's awesome. So, it's awesome. So I actually brought you and Jesse on the same show. I've been trying to orchestrate this forever.
Did you actually orchestrate that?
This is on purpose.
Okay. I was wondering,
four-time charm, I think.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
we try it for a while now. Okay. So.
Because I really wanted the two of you guys to be on the same show because you've got that awesome clothing brand. And then Jesse has been through hell and back. I mean, reading his bio and stuff, it's a great theme. And I'm so glad that we missed because now we get to do this show on Thanksgiving. And you've overcome so much adversity in your life that it's shocking.
It does shock me. Like
Well, tell us about it.
Tell us about it
for our listeners out there.
Yeah, so I'll take you through a synopsis of it here. So I was 21 years old. This is 9 years ago. Doing high fashion fitness modeling in New York City.
Okay. Who are you with?
Who was I with? I was with Silver Models, okay. Doing work with Kalfen Klein, Tommy Hilfiger, CN2 underwear, doing underwear modeling.
You look familiar, that's why I asked.
Maybe. It was a while ago. It's a while ago, though. People, you probably saw it on the internet and stuff. But honestly, you know, living the high life of my dreams, right, is something that I always wanted to do. And I was working catering on the side as well and had the opportunity of doing runway shows and stuff like that. It was amazing. I was so happy. It was like a dream come true. I'd worked for it my whole life. I grew up on a farm, for God's sake. So yeah, for me doing this, you know, it was like something I really enjoyed. And I work in a catering job one night, and I went to a bar to have a few drinks with a friend and got roofied at the bar. And I ran to Penn Station to get my train because it's like 3 o'clock in the morning, Sunday on December the 3rd. And I got to Penn Station, and last thing I remember is standing in front of the catwalk of the train, right in front of where the door closes, and blacking out. And it's not like, you know, you drink, like I had 5-6 drinks, like, right, you know, your tolerance, yeah, right? Okay, so I'm standing in front of this train, it's like somebody gave me a shot of morphine, like this, like my world went upside down.
Wow.
Like the train's turning, like I can't tell what's going on. I'm trying to stand up straight. And I woke up on top of the catwalk of the train. And I don't know if you know where the catwalk of the train is, but that's on top of the train. And people are like, how'd you get there? I'm like, ask the roofie.
Yeah, that's right? A good question.
Yeah, right. Like people, I get that on my social media. It's like, how'd you get there? I'm like, ask the roofie. Don't know. You know, you take one of those things happen, right?
Ask the roofie and then you're on a roof.
Let me know and we'll both, you know, not explain this thing.
That's actually funny because I never put two and two together that roofies could actually result
in
you.
Make you on a roof.
Yeah.
Not to make light of it.
That's hysterical. I'm nervous. Yeah, I was like, it was a roofie, okay? It's where you end up.
Yeah, those things. That's a great tagline in there somewhere.
You can steal that if you'd like.
That's the first tagline for roofies.
Take
right?
that. That's my gift to you.
Stole that. Thank you, Jared. That's hysterical. So yeah, I ended me up on the roof of a train, and I was up there for about 45 minutes because he had me on camera. And after I woke up,
The train going?
No, this thing was no. The train was not going.
Thank God.
Luckily, it was on lockdown.
Okay.
It was I was so out of it and incoherent when I ran down Penn Station through the anybody's been there, they have the escalators, you run down, right, you got the huge concrete platforms.
Yeah.
I was booking it down that thing, trying to get my train. I'm telling you, when I read the monitor, this thing was like, I couldn't read, like it was fuzzy. So I had already getting effects, but I didn't realize what was going on. I'm like, what's going on?
Well,
what the
damn, I'm
happening?
A cheap
Well,
today.
It was probably the running like, that kind of pumped all that stuff into your bloodstream really, really quick.
Probably. Yeah. So, because I booked it and I'm like, man, I'm a really cheap dater. I'm drunk quick. This is weird.
Wow.
So I ended up standing in front of the train. It really wasn't funny. Like I'm like trying to collect myself.
Hindsight.
Yeah. And honestly, I'm freaking out.
Because I'm like, off your smiles.
Yeah. It's like,
sober.
This isn't cool. So I'm standing in front of it trying to figure out what's going on. And when you wake up 40 minutes later on top of the catwalk of the train, what went through my head is what probably would have went through yours. What the hell am I doing here?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So definitely.
The obvious question.
Yeah. It's like, well, this is weird. So I'm standing, laying down on my stomach, okay? I'm laying on the catwalk of the train on the steps where the conductors walk to check wiring, whatnot, yada, yada. And I take a look to the right side of me and I see like a rod that's like the size of my pinky, and I look to the left and it's the edge of the train 8 feet down the concrete, and I'm like, well, I'll grab a hold of this rod to stabilize myself because it's outside of a heater core
cage. See where this is going.
And I'm like, well, I don't want to fall off the edge, so I'm going to grab a hold of this rod and turn my body around because I saw steps in front of me.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Were your clothes on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. All clothes were on. All
this,
right.
This actually, they shouldn't have been. It'd have been better if they were.
That's what I was thinking.
No, I'm serious. Because I had a nylon backpack that was filled full of books and papers on top of a cotton shirt. I'll get there in a second.
Yeah.
So I grab a hold of this rod wire to stabilize myself to try to flip my body around, still not cognitive of everything that's going on and very delusional, okay? It's like when you wake up out of anesthesia. That's how I felt like.
Everything's fuzzy.
Oh, everything was fuzzy. Funky, weird feeling. I'm trying to make a rational decision here and get off the top of this train.
Right.
And so I grab a hold of it and go to flip around, and it's 13,800 three-phase. At 13,800 three-phase, it turns you into a burner. I mean.
So there was an electrical current going through that cord.
Oh, yeah. And it's 13,800. It's going to you know, it'd be like turning the burner on a stove. It actually boiled the blood inside my arm.
Woo!
I mean, this wow. is a little gnarly, but seriously, it's 958.65 degrees at that temperature going in the inlet side, and it burns from the inside out. On top of that, everything on you is static electricity, right. So it caught my backpack on fire. This thing's melting over my back, all over my stomach, and my shirt's caught on fire. I'm just like, I'm a ball of fire.
Human explosive.
Yeah, I'm a ball of fire on top of the train. So I holding this thing, and at that moment, like, you know, you have that thought that goes through your head, like, this is it, I'm done. Like, it was the worst pain. I would rather been shot 10 times or a hatchet stuck on my leg. I mean, it's horrible. You burn your finger.
Yeah.
Tell me that
it hurts like hell.
Yeah, it hurts like hell.
So worst pain on earth.
Yeah, so there's such a thing as a 6-degree burn. I had from first to six, 60% of my upper body.
Wow.
So I'm trying to breathe because the pain is so intense that you can't breathe. I'm like yelling and I blacked out and I actually died. No joke. I had a vision. Like I went through a tunnel, came out the top of the tunnel.
Yeah.
I had the whole death vision thing. All right. It's enough electricity that it restarts your heart again. So this, you can't tell you the time lapse when you die.
Well, plus you're still probably affected by the roofie on top of the electrocution.
So, you know, this could be
roofie might have saved your life.
Yeah, right? A whole lot. Ended it and saved it at the same time, right?
Yeah.
So I'm this is a few seconds period, right? And I grab a hold of the wire. I'm trying to breathe. I black out. I have this vision. I come back. And when I wake back up, I'm engulfed in flames at this time. And I'm trying to breathe. And it restarted my heart. So I grab
what restarted your heart?
The electricity. It's 13,800 volts.
So it's like it killed you and then it defibbed you.
Yeah, and it defibrillated me right back because it was actually grounding.
You don't get that every day. Right.
No.
Not
it was grounding
paramedics.
Off the side of my chest. Yeah. So I grab a hold of the edge of the train, and what went through my head is like, if I don't pull myself off this wire, because you can't release.
Yeah, it's hard to release. Yeah, when you're being
electrocuted. You can't release at that voltage. It won't let you go. So if I grab a hold of the side of the train and I pull myself, and I just, with every last breath I had in between my yelling and screaming, I grabbed a hold of the edge of the train and pulled my hand free and fell 8 feet on the concrete. It was the most relieved feeling in my entire life. Like, the pain just stopped for a second, but then there was like crackling and popping because I was still on, you know, my backpack was burning. So there was a guy that came and put me out of the fire extinguisher. They called the fire department. It made the New York Times news that day. Like they gave me 2 days to live. They're like, this guy's done.
For some reason, I remember that story. Like, I remember that story. That story sounds familiar.
It was a big deal.
Yeah, that story really sounds familiar.
Yeah, and there was the social media was even like coming at me, like, you know, say, hey, he was doing cocaine, he was cracked out on top of the, you know, he's doing drugs, and he was on top of the train. And
you can think of better places to do drugs.
Like, yeah, right.
I'm like, yeah, that would be a night, right?
Making let's you the right perpetrator the rather than the victim, right?
No, so I was like fighting social media on top of everything I'm going through. Run through this semi quickly. I was in a coma for 2 months.
2 months.
I spent another month after that doing rehabilitation, learning to walk, talk, breathe on my own again. When I woke up out of my coma, the only way I could actually tell it was me is because my eyes were blue. That's how nutrition deficient I was. Like, it literally, I was 143 pounds at 6'2".
Yeah, Jesus.
That's disgusting.
Yeah.
And at that point, people asked me, like, what was the will to survive?
Yeah.
I didn't want to survive. Like, I begged the doctors to, like, unhook me. I'm serious. And I would quit breathing on the respirator at night, and they would take a tack and shove it in my toe to make me gasp for air. They're like, it was horrible. I'm like, just let me go.
We ain't having no deaths up in this motherfucker.
They would let me go. And I actually remember kicking the nurse's hand when she went to shove the tack in. Like, I mean, I smashed the back of the, like, almost smashed her hand clear in the back of the bed. Mm. And my mom's like, Jesse, that's not nice.
You're like,
and
she's stuck a tack in my
foot.
I'm
like, she's tacking me and I'm trying to die.
trying to die here.
Yeah.
Why does everyone leave me alone?
It's sounds not like a problem. It's not funny, but honestly.
Yeah. Hindsight, you know, I'm
like,
obviously.
I was at that point. Like, I didn't look like myself. Come on, you're doing modeling for a career. That's gone, as far as I knew.
Right, then.
Like, I never saw myself getting in front of a camera, ever taking my shirt off. I mean, it was bad. Like, you see people with burns, and it just makes you cringe.
Well, it's crazy. It's like it's like you're destined for fame, because at one point you're going and you're getting on, you know, you're doing all these ads and you're getting on camera and you're about to be famous, and then you have what would have killed most people and turned your life around into a completely, you know, I wouldn't say a blessing in disguise, but a completely different kind of fame. And you know, now what you're about is helping people and empowering people, right?
I mean, that's, yeah, exactly. Which yeah, is people awesome. Ask me, what's your purpose? I'm like, my purpose is clear. Like, to inspire people, to motivate them. We all have hardship. We all have crap we go through.
Yeah.
Okay? You can never judge a book by its cover. You look at some people and you're like, oh, that person's doing so good. You have no clue what that person's been
the
through.
The grass is always
Jesse, greener. tell me about when the transition was. When you went from, okay, I really don't want to live, you know what I'm saying, to I want to live. I want to go on. Tell me about that.
That went on for 3 years, okay? I did a lot of drinking, tell us a lot the process. Of partying, a lot of...
What year was this again?
This is 2007.
Okay.
Because it was December 3rd. So I was out of the hospital. It was February 29th of 2007.
Mm-hmm. So that's great. Wow. You got to you got to come out of the hospital right when the economy collapsed and everything went to shit.
Yeah.
Which only made it worse. You're like, the whole world's ending. Yeah, and I didn't get to die.
Yeah, it was economy, my life, and yada.
That sucks.
So, again, we're not laughing at the situation.
No, hey, I mean, you know, I'm not laughing at either, but come on, like, you gotta laugh.
You know, I have a question for you. You've overcome it.
Did you have to switch hands?
I did. No, that was actually a pain in the ass.
Oh, no, it is. Yes,
like, right? Literally.
Oh, is that where we're going? Turned into anal?
I broke my right hand doing jiu-jitsu once, and I had to learn how to use my left for everything for about 2-3 months. So I can imagine that would be a difficult thing for you. And
did you ever try it with that?
Man, that would, you know, I don't want that thing smashing down.
Next subject. So, totally. Ian, do you feel like you, I mean, you run a clothing brand that basically sponsors people like this. Do you hear similar stories, and where is the turning point for most people? I want to see if we can get a correlating moment, if you will.
Sure. It's actually interesting. I was just about to say, just like Jesse's story, you know, I reach out to a lot of people who are at the top, and almost all of them, it's a very common that they overcame something. I'm not saying as great as, you know, as unreal as Jesse's story, but they really overcame something in order to get where they're at. If they kind of just, they started off good or whatnot, they would never get better. And I want to even ask Jesse, like, do you think you would have your physique, have your mindset if this never happened to you?
Probably more the mindset. Would you have this mindset?
I wouldn't have this mindset that I have now. The physique, I mean, I ask myself, I'm like, good God, you imagine what I'd look like if I had two arms? I mean, even, you know, though I have the physique I have, you know, with what I've been through, but I can't go there. But it's definitely changed my perspective towards human life, mm-hmm. towards what we've gone through, towards hardship. I mean, honestly, my grandpa had his arm missing. Okay.
So
a lot of people don't know that. And it's not like it's predestined, but my grandpa got it caught in a grain elevator. And it twisted it off. So
not predestined, but you just don't hear that.
Yeah, you don't hear that. And I always thought my grandpa, I'm like, man, that sucks, Paul. You know what I mean? I'm like,
but you could understand it.
But I could understand it. Exactly. But when it happened to me, I'm like, you gotta be like, what? Like,
yeah,
this is not, honestly, like, you have no idea. There's so many nights I went to sleep at night, like crying my eyes out, like drugged out on Oxycontin and like praying to God that I would wake up the next day and this was a dream. Mm-hmm. Like, it was didn't seem real. It went on for months and months, and finally it's like, well, here's the reality. So, you know, I'm going through surgeries. I had
skin grafts,
14 surgeries to go through consecutively year after year. It took about 4 years, five years to get through all those. I mean, I can't work much. I can't, you know, like, you're in and out of surgeries.
Through hell and back, literally. Through hell and back, literally.
I did a lot of partying, a lot of drinking, and you know, I got two DUIs. What really stopped the stuff is two DUIs ended me up in jail for 28 days, and I'm cut out for a lot of things, but not jail.
Yeah.
I'm cut out for death, but not jail. Yeah. But jail's a whole other thing.
Like, people are like, it's just 28 days in jail. I'm like, I don't like concrete walls.
Well, it's funny because I actually met Jesse at the gym.
I thought you were going to say at the jail. Did you not think that was coming?
No, I met him at the gym, and I remember sitting there thinking, like, I just wanted to snap a picture of him, but I didn't want to be rude, and I was going to hashtag the picture, like, the next time you're having a bad fucking day. Like, and then, or the next time you're sitting there feeling lazy and fat, like you don't want to go to the gym. I'm looking at this guy and he's benching more than I could ever bench, more than I could fucking squat. And he's just over here just pounding it out. And I'm like, is he missing a fucking arm? And he's, I was just, it was inspiring. I was like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, and I mean, you can, people can Google you and see what you look like without your shirt off, but it's pretty fucking impressive. I mean, I'm sitting here and I'm like,
thank you.
That dude's buffer than me. Like, look at him over there. And he's just like pounding it out. And I was like, you know what? There's no excuse. There's no excuse to no lay excuses. Over and fucking die. Was that Ian? Ian.
Hello? Ian, you there?
Yeah. We got you?
Yeah, I missed that. I can't hear you very well.
Oh, I'm sorry. I said there's no excuse to lay over and fucking die.
Oh, there's none at all. You know, it's all about your inner passion and your drive, and you got to love what you do, and that's so clear.
What inspired you to start doing this, Ian?
That's a good question. I always wanted to start something up, but more important than that, I saw a lot of people who didn't get recognized for the hard work and for what they've accomplished. I love the celebrity talk and all that as well, but I wanted to kind of take a reverse turn on it and reward the people, the average person, as you if you will.
For lack of a better term.
by doing that by inner confidence and not necessarily wanting to be someone else, but wanting to be yourself and the best you can be.
Yeah, that's great.
That's the best thing.
So tell me about the people around you in going through this. Your family, your friends. You know, how was that experience?
I'm actually very glad you brought that up, because besides for my dad, a lot of people were actually telling me not to do this. Especially, you know, as I was just getting going, just getting started, they wanted me to take a more safe route. And that's just not me. I have to kind of unleash passion. I really want to inspire other people to do their things. So I'm very happy that you asked that, because unfortunately, people around you are not always on your side. Mm-hmm. And as I grew, it's still kind of the case. It's really weird that the more people that I don't know are actually more for me than the people around me. So it's so interesting that you brought that up.
Friends can be enemies, and enemies can be friends. And I'll bounce that question back to you, Jesse. Like, you know, in terms of going through this process, this emotional process, your friends, your family, where do they lie? You know, did that go through a transition? Was it not normal? The reason I ask is I had people with, you know, gone through traumatic experiences, defects, and things like that. And I've always been the person, if I see them, I'm going to act the same exact way. I may talk about it. You know what I'm saying? Because that's the person you are now.
Right.
And to normalize that, to normalize the situation, I think is very cathartic for someone. You know what I'm saying? It stabilizes their emotional state as a person in going through this ride. How was that for you? Did your friends and family normalize it, or was it always the pink elephant in the room?
I'd say that's a good analogy and a good question. You know what? The biggest thing is for somebody that goes through something like this, they want to feel normal. Mm-hmm. They want to feel accepted. And I'm going to tell you, from my perspective, I can't lower my standards. I can't view myself any differently. I wasn't born like this. For instance, you take a $20 bill, you tear it up, smash it, throw it around, beat the crap out of it, do whatever you can do. That thing is still worth $20.
That's right.
So is every human.
That's right.
And that's a great analogy.
That's powerful right there, brother.
Now you actually have character. You have growth, you have wisdom, and it honestly sucks. Like, I'm like, really, you got to go through all this to get to this?
Trust me, I've been there.
but and it hurts, dude. It really freaking hurts. But at the end of the day, it's like, man, like, with a massive dream and a great goal comes hardship. Mm-hmm. You don't have successful people have hardship.
Well, it's
so
funny.
So literally, that bolt that went through your body lit your inner core.
Yeah. Well, I went through my destructive years in recovery. I mean, it's hard, man. Like that was
it's a journey.
Rough.
It's a journey.
But I tell you, you're like, well, what kind of woke you up? Well, sitting in jail for 29 days and is at the bottom of my ladder for me, and I'm going. Mm-hmm. I'm done, dude. Right. It's either up or
not. When you get to your bottom, you have one decision to make.
Yeah, and I was so miserable. I was so depressed, and I was just like, I'm done. I'm going to try to start squatting and stuff like that. So I started squatting, and because I didn't have a prosthesis at the time.
Oh, okay.
They were still fitting, going through insurance. I mean, these things are the price of a new Mercedes, so you can't just grab one.
Right. Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll take a left arm.
Yeah, to right. Go.
Pick and pull.
Right. Yeah, it's crazy because a lot of people don't associate. I wouldn't even call it hardship. I want to go back to that real quick, because I sincerely think that, you know, when you were talking about goal, a dream, a passion, a vision, and you know you have to go through all this stuff to get there. It's not hardship necessarily. I think that you tell the universe, hey, I want this thing, and the universe goes, cool, here's how you're going to get it, and it puts a weight set in front of you. And it's just like lifting weights. You go, hey, I want to be on stage someday and admired for my body. Well, you're going to have to lift weights to get there.
It's the journey.
And yeah, and I think that in a lot of respects, when you say, hey, this is what I want, the universe goes, okay, and people think, why is this so hard? And it's like they don't realize that literally you're going through the SWAT training course or the, you know, the obstacle course, if you will, to get to that the mass peak of your potential. Which,
yeah, the guy on the top of the mountain didn't fall there.
Exactly.
The guy on the top of the mountain didn't fall there. Listeners, take that home and Thanksgiving for that, right?
That's a great one.
Eat some pumpkin pie with that one right there.
So yeah, it's all what, coming from a coaching standpoint, honestly, what you think is what you create.
Yeah.
And if you have negative intentions and you're like, you know, I don't know if I can do this, you're right. If you say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do whatever it takes, I don't care how hard it looks, I'm not going to quit until I get there, you'll get it.
And Jesse, I'm trying to get at your drive and your passion, because there are listeners out there that are probably maybe going through the same thing right now, maybe at their darkest point.
Yeah.
You know, what is it? Where is it? You know, where is that transition? You know, so anyone out there that's listening, maybe right there, that you can probably, you know, yeah, just give them that next dot on their journey to hopefully change their trajectory.
Coming from the bottom of the hole. When you're at your lowest point, and you're like, people can tell you all the sweet cookies and cream they want, right? They can come and you say, hey, you know, just hang in there, do it. That doesn't click.
Mm-hmm.
You have to.
They don't know what you've been through either.
Yeah, and they're gonna go, you don't understand, because I did that. Like, you don't understand. You don't. Your situation is different than mine. You can't relate to this.
You're not in my shoes.
Yeah, you're not in my shoes. You don't know what it feels like. Okay, I agree with you, but here's where it starts. You need to dig deep inside you and find something that you love to do.
Yeah.
What do you love to do?
Greater love.
I had to do this. And you have to be passionate about it, because with where you stand, first of all, you're ripping the world off, because you can't feel sorry for yourself, and people need you. I'm telling you, like, I don't do this for myself. I do this for the people around me in the world now, truthfully. If I'm in there and lifting in the gym, yeah, it's to make me a better me, but it's to motivate and inspire the people that have went through lesser or greater things than me, and we all need that.
Yeah.
Or may someday, hopefully not, have to go through something.
Yeah, or learn. Yeah, try to learn too. Learn from that. See, man, now I don't want to go there. Like, you know, learn from other people's mistakes. But when you're at the bottom, you need to find something that drives you. And I'm going to tell you the one thing that I have loved since I was a kid is lifting and working out. I'm going to tell you why. Because it's the best natural antidepressant, and it will never, ever rip you off. I don't care where you are. Honestly, you can go to the gym.
Doctors should prescribe that instead of all the medication.
Yeah, it's here, right?
I mean, for God's sake.
A lot of doctors would, if they could also prescribe motivation. Unfortunately, the gym isn't, for a lot of people, it's a definite thing that helps. It's incredible for everything that you're talking about. But making somebody care, making somebody want to get off their ass, you know, get out of a hospital bed, then get over the skin grafts, which basically made you feel like you were in an inner tube, right?
Oh, it was horrible.
Like everything was squeezed tight. And then not only that, but then getting a prosthetic arm and still having to go and rebuild the body that had been destroyed. It's like, I want for all our listeners out there, the next time you're feeling lazy on the couch, remember this motherfucker.
So Jesse, also tell us about your coaching techniques. Is it more of like tough love, or is it more empathetic, you know, just in terms of, you know, and how that differs from different coaching techniques for other life coaches?
It really You can't coach everybody the same.
All right, guys. Mm-hmm. We actually have to cut this one short. But what I want to do is, Jesse, where can people find you? And Ian, where can people find you?
GLP underscore fitness is Instagram and Twitter.
Okay.
Accounts. Thank
awesome.
You all.
We're going to have a follow-up show with you guys. We had to make this one a little short. But Jesse, where can people find you?
You can find me on Instagram at Bionic Jesse.
Bionic Jesse. Yeah.
Boom. Yeah, definitely check that out for some motivation. And I'm on Twitter, Jesse Sink, and I'm on Facebook at Jesse Sink.
Awesome.
So check that out.
I'm so sad we didn't even get to Brooke. Brooke, where can
That's
people find
okay.
you?
You know what? I just wanted to be here with you guys.
I
wanted to bring the sexy to the
room. We are thankful for that.
I'll have links to both Jesse and GLP Movement on my website, Methodology of the Modern Male.
And from Modern Male, happy Thanksgiving. Don't eat too much
happy
or eat too much, but just remember to exercise if you do eat too much.
Get your butt off the couch and work it off.
Exactly.
And that's all for tonight, folks. Thanks for tuning in to Modern Male Radio.
Modern Male. Peace.
You're listening to Modern Male Radio with Jerod Zavistoski and Sydney Hall, right here on LA Talk Radio.